Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ruff Justice by Laurien Berenson. Narrated by Angie Hickman. Chapter 1. It is a truth universally acknowledged that a standard poodle in possession of 11 points toward a championship must be in want of a dog show. Okay, Jane Austen didn't use those exact words. But if she had been a member of my family, she might well have, because dog shows are a way of life for us. I met my husband Sam at a dog show, and our blended canine crew currently includes 5 black standard poodles and a small spotted mutt named Bud. All our poodles are retired show champions, except for one, Kirkwood's Keep Away, more casually known as Augie. He belongs to my 13-year-old son, Davy. A novice dog handler with plenty of other interests to keep him busy, Davy had been working on finishing Augie's championship for nearly 2 years. Now we were all in agreement that it was time to finally buckle down and get the job done, which had brought us to yet another dog show. Like all exhibitors, we were eternal optimists. Connecticut weather in early April was notoriously fickle. Though the show scene had moved back outdoors for the spring season, the day was chilly enough for everyone to be bundled into warm jackets. Still, after a winter spent at often cramped indoor venues, we were all delighted to be outside in a spacious park. The air might have been unseasonably brisk, but at least it wasn't raining or snowing. 12 large rings had been set up in the center of the big field. They were positioned in 2 rows of 6 with a wide alleyway between them, covered by a green and white striped tent. At each end of the competition area was another smaller tent where exhibitors set up their grooming equipment and completed their pre-show ring preparations. By the time we arrived mid-morning, most of the available space under the grooming tent nearest the poodle ring had already been claimed by the professional handlers who'd been at the show site since dawn. Sam pulled the SUV into the unloading area beside the tent. I got out and had a look around, hoping to find a small spot to wedge our gear in. The scene beneath the tent was hectic. I saw dozens of wooden crates stacked on top of each other, and rows of rubber-matted grooming tables squashed into narrow aisles. I heard the loud, persistent whine of freestanding blow dryers. Some exhibitors were working on their dogs, while others were dashing back and forth to the rings. To the uninitiated, it might have looked like pandemonium. To me, it looked like home. Suddenly, a familiar head popped up. A hand lifted and waved in the air. "Melanie?" Aunt Peg called. "Over here." Even in the midst of all that chaos, Margaret Turnbull was hard to overlook. She stood 6 feet tall and had a direct gaze that missed nothing. Her posture was impeccable, and her demeanor was that of a woman who knew exactly what she wanted and almost always got it. Over the decades, Aunt Peg's successes in the dog show world had earned her a reputation for excellence and the lasting respect of her peers. Her Cedar Crest kennel had not only produced a number of the country's best standard poodles, it had also provided foundation stock for those discerning breeders who'd followed in her footsteps. Now nearing 70, Aunt Peg had scaled back her involvement in breeding and exhibiting to concentrate on her busy career as a multi-group judge. She'd had a litter of standard poodle puppies the previous fall, her first in several years. I knew she'd retained the best bitch puppy for herself, but now I was surprised to see Aunt Peg standing in the middle of her own setup. The poodle, Cedar Crest Coral, was sitting on a grooming table beside her. It looked as though Aunt Peg would be showing today, too. Somehow she'd neglected to mention that. Aunt Peg had a word with the puppy, then left her sitting on her monogram towel. She slipped through the setups between us and came to help unload the SUV. The four of us worked together with a practiced ease born of repetition. By the time Aunt Peg and I reached the vehicle, Sam already had the hatch open. He'd pulled out the dolly, and he and Davy were loading Augie's crate onto it. In my sometimes crazy world, Sam was my rock. We'd known each other for nearly a decade and been married for half that time. I loved that he was smart and perceptive. I also loved that Sam had sun-bleached blonde hair, a killer smile, and a body buff enough to draw second looks from girls half our age. As I reached around him to grab the wooden tack box, I trailed my fingers across Sam's back. He shifted slightly in my direction and winked. Davy was threading a noose carefully through Augie's thick neck hair before hopping the big poodle out of the car. He caught the interaction between his stepfather and me and shook his head. 13 was a tough age for kids and parents both.
What about me? Asked a plaintive voice. What should I carry?
Our younger son, Kevin, had turned 4 in March. He was enrolled in preschool now. As a consequence, he was feeling very grown up. I looked around for something to hand him and settled upon a small, soft-sided cooler.
You can take this, I said.
Kev thrust out his lower lip.
I want something big.
Aunt Peg leaned down and examined my choice.
Don't lose that. It's very important. The cooler has Augie's bait in it. Without it, Davy will be in trouble when he goes in the ring.
The thought of his brother in trouble immediately brightened my younger son's face. Kevin had his father's sandy hair and slate blue eyes. When he smiled, it was like looking at a version of Sam in miniature.
I have Augie's bait, he echoed happily. Cool.
We moved Aunt Peg's equipment to one side and squeezed our own stuff in next to it. Sam wedged the crate up against a tent pole. Then he and Kev went to move the SUV to the parking lot. I put the tack box within easy reach on top of the crate and stashed the cooler and Kevin's toy bag behind it. Davy set up the grooming table. When it was ready, he lifted Augie up into place. I saw him cast a glance in Coral's direction and frown. Aunt Peg's pretty puppy had already been brushed out. With her dense black coat and soft dark eyes, she looked like a perfect plush doll. When Davy looked her way, Coral stood up and wagged her tail. What's the matter? I asked him.
Aunt Peg is showing.
I understood his consternation. It had been a long time since I'd seen Aunt Peg in a ring with a poodle on the end of her leash.
Now we'll have 2 chances to win, I said brightly.
Now I'll have to beat her too,
Davy grumbled.
You have a dog and I have a bitch,
Aunt Peg reminded him.
We won't meet in the classes. And besides, Coral is only 6 months old. We're just here for the experience.
I leaned down and whispered to Davy. You should be happy Aunt Peg has her own entry to concentrate on. That'll give her less time to worry about what you and Augie are doing.
I heard that,
Aunt Peg snapped. The woman has ears like a fox. Ignoring her, I opened the tack box and took out the tools Davy would need to start preparing Augie for the ring. A fully mature standard poodle dog, Augie was wearing the Continental clip, one of 3 trims approved for AKC breed competition. His face and throat were clipped to the skin, and he had a dense coat of long, shaped hair covering the front half of his body. His hind quarter and legs were mostly shaved as well, leaving only rounded rosettes on each of his hips, bracelets on his lower legs, and a large pom-pom on the end of his tail. Beginning the grooming session required a pin brush, a slicker brush, a greyhound comb, and a water bottle for misting the coat. I lined up the equipment along the edge of the tabletop. Davy looped his arms around Augie's legs and gently lowered the poodle into a prone position. Augie knew what to expect. He relaxed and lay quietly on his left side. Hands moving quickly through the hair, Davy started line brushing the poodle's mane coat.
I see the gang's all here, said Terry D'Annunzio.
Sweeping past me with a Japanese chin tucked beneath each arm, he aimed an air kiss in my direction.
Finally,
he added with a smirk. That last part was a dig at Aunt Peg, who always beat us to shows, then complained vociferously that we were late, even when we had hours to spare. Assistant to top professional handler Crawford Langley, Terry was one of my best buddies. In his 30s, he was a few years younger than me and impossibly cute. He was also flamboyantly gay. Terry's antics were the perfect foil for Crawford's calm, dignified manner. The two of them made a great couple. Terry often entertained himself by taking pot shots at people. And since it wasn't unusual for me to be the target of his biting wit, now I couldn't resist having some fun at his expense. Terry's hair color seemed to change with his moods, or maybe the time of day. But this tint was something I hadn't seen before. "Red?" I said incredulously. "You've got to be kidding."
"What?"
He stashed the two toy dogs in a pair of crates and straightened and twirled for effect.
"You don't love it?"
"I don't even like it," I wrinkled my nose. "You look like Howdy Doody."
"That's what I told him."
Crawford entered the neighboring setup from the other side. He was carrying another chin and a fistful of ribbons.
"And I said,"
Terry paused and looked around to make sure we were all listening.
"Who the heck is Howdy Doody?"
Back at her own grooming table, Aunt Peg barked out a laugh.
"Good for you, Terry. It's wise to be impervious to insult."
"Who are we insulting now?" Bertie Kennedy came flying into the tent, towing a bearded collie. Another professional handler, Bertie was married to my younger brother, Frank. The couple had two children, 6-year-old Maggie and a son named Josh, who'd been born the previous September. Crawford had been showing dogs successfully for decades. Bertie's experience comprised only a fraction of that time. But she was talented and worked hard. The fact that she was tall and gorgeous didn't hurt either. As she hopped the bearded onto a nearby table, I leaned over to give her a hug. Apparently, the setup on our other side belonged to her. "Terry," I told her, "we're laughing at his hair."
"Hey."
She pulled back and gave me a stern look.
"I could be offended by that."
Bertie's hair was a deep, rich shade of auburn. Terry's was flaming red.
"You tell him, doll."
Terry plucked a mini poodle out of a crate and went to work.
"We redheads have to stick together."
"At least until Tuesday or so," I said. "By then he'll probably be blonde again."
"Somebody woke up on the wrong side of the bed this morning."
Terry fluttered his fingers in Aunt Peg's direction.
"Competition a little tough for you today?"
"I might ask the same of you," I shot back. Davy was showing one standard poodle. Crawford and Terry had three. And as Aunt Peg had pointed out earlier, since the initial classes were divided by sex, it was unlikely that Augie and Coral would meet in the show ring.
"You two quit fussing."
Aunt Peg was busy putting up her puppy's top knot.
"Coral is a baby. She's just here to learn what dog shows are all about." "A puppy of yours needing experience?"
Sam said. He and Kev had returned from parking the SUV.
"That sounds unlikely."
Sam released Kevin's hand, and I handed my son the bag of toys. He sat down on the grass, took out a pair of matchbox cars, and began to zoom them around the table legs.
"I can't believe how much I've missed this,"
Aunt Peg said with a smile.
"It's been entirely too long since I had a poodle to show. Judging is a wonderful way to give back to the sport, but this..."
She waved a hand to encompass all the activity under the tent and the other exhibitors around us.
"This is what it's really about. The dogs, the grooming, the competition, the camaraderie."
"The smell of hairspray in the morning?" I teased.
"Laugh if you will, but I'm perfectly serious. Judging is a fruitful occupation and agility is loads of fun, but nothing can compare with the satisfaction you feel walking into the breed ring with a beautiful homebred dog on the end of your leash."
"Hear, hear," said Crawford.
The rest of us nodded in agreement. Dog shows had an addictive quality, and we were all well aware of it. The competition was always interesting, and occasionally even rewarding. But that was only part of the equation. Exhibiting gave breeders the opportunity to form relationships, to compare notes, to analyze the results of their efforts. We came to the show for the dogs, but the people were every bit as important.
"Speaking of judging," said Sam, "when are you going to apply for a license, Crawford?"
The handler gave him a sideways look.
Is that your way of saying you think I'm of an age where I ought to be slowing down?
Sam reddened. I'd rarely seen him at a loss for words, but now he looked as if he wished he'd never asked the question. I quickly intervened. What Sam meant, Crawford, is that the judging pool would be enriched by your experience and expertise.
That's what I thought.
The handler cracked a grin.
But the judging pool will have to wait. I'm too busy doing what I do best.
He swept a toy poodle off a tabletop and exited the tent. Terry picked up two more ring-ready toys and followed.
That's my cue, said Bertie.
She left with a duck toller.
And mine as well,
Aunt Peg announced.
Keep an eye on Coral for me, will you? I'll be back in just a few minutes.
Where are you going? I asked.
I decided that a return to the ring deserved a nice new piece of equipment. I ordered a beaded show leash for Coral from Jasmine Crane. She told me it would be ready for pickup today.
Sam and I exchanged a look. We were both remembering that most of Aunt Peg's old equipment had burned up in a kennel fire the previous summer. That sounds perfect, I said. Jasmine's leashes are beautiful. Every dog show drew a variety of canine-centric concession booths, offering all manner of dog-related products. I'd seen everything from sheepskin beds and squeaky toys to canine books and figurines. In Vendor's Row, there was something for every dog lover to drool over. Jasmine Crane's specialty was canine art. Working in oils and pastels, she created original paintings and took commissions for pet portraits. Jasmine was a skilled artist, deft at capturing both her subjects' looks and their personalities. When passing by her booth, I'd often admired the merchandise she had on display. Recently, Jasmine had expanded into the growing market for custom-made collars and leashes. Her eye for color and symmetry lent her products a special flair, and her strap works were quickly becoming as popular as her art. Like all show poodles, Coral was table-trained. When Aunt Peg left, Coral lay down on the tabletop with her head between her front paws, patiently waiting for Aunt Peg to return. Davy had finished line brushing Augie and put on his slender show collar. Now Sam supervised as Davy parted the long hair on the poodle's head and banded together the numerous ponytails that would support Augie's towering topknot. Davy and Sam were spraying up Augie's coat when Aunt Peg reappeared 10 minutes later. Let me see, I held out my hand. I bet it's gorgeous.
I'd be delighted to show it to you,
Aunt Peg replied unhappily.
Except I don't have it. Jasmine wasn't in her booth. I even waited a few minutes hoping she'd return, but she never showed up. That's odd,
Sam commented.
How does she expect to make sales if she isn't there for her customers? I haven't a clue.
Aunt Peg sounded huffy.
And it's very disappointing. I had that leash made specially so I could start Coral's career off right. Now we'll have to do without.
Davy looked over.
I can lend you a lead, Aunt Peg. I have extras. Thank you, but no.
She walked over and dug around in her tack box.
I have a leash. It's just not the right leash.
Aunt Peg reveled in her dog show superstitions. Heaven forbid you wished her luck before she went in the ring. She would react as though you'd driven a dagger into her heart. Davy looked at me and shrugged. I returned the gesture. Aunt Peg sighed, loudly.
There's nothing to be done for it. We shall simply have to rise above.
My sympathy for her plight was muted. Trust me, if anyone was capable of rising above, it was surely Aunt Peg. She took out her scissors and applied the final finish to Coral's trim. Over an hour setup, Sam and Davy were doing the same to Augie. Crawford and Terry came running back to the tent with their toy poodles. They exchanged them for the standards and quickly got ready to leave again. Aunt Peg lifted Coral off her grooming table and set her on the ground. Davy followed suit with Augie. In a procession of poodles, we all headed over to the ring. Following behind with Kevin, I felt a frisson of excitement in the air. Things were about to get serious. It was time to find out if all the hard work we'd done to ready Augie for the show had been worth it. For Davy's sake, I really hoped today was going to be his day.
Chapter 2.
Poodles come in three varieties divided by size. From the tiniest city apartment to the expanse of a rural ranch, a poodle can fit anywhere. Despite their differences in stature, all poodles share the same whip-smart, eager-to-please, fun-loving disposition. Plus, they're people dogs, so most are kind enough to hide the fact that they can outthink their owners. There's nothing a poodle enjoys more than a good joke, especially one at their person's expense. Though the breed was originally developed to retrieve, the gaiety of the poodle temperament is uniquely suited to the show ring. Poodles are natural entertainers. In the breed ring, the judge is looking for a sound, typey dog with correct conformation. But poodles bring something more. They walk into a show ring and make it their own. They play with their handlers. They flirt with the spectators. They charm the socks off the judges. Poodles understand that dog shows are supposed to be fun, and they want everyone else to be having a great time too. We cross the short expanse between the handler's tent and the show ring in the company of more than a dozen other standard poodles. Davy kept Augie close to his side. His right hand was holding the end of the lead. His left was cupped beneath the dog's muzzle. His arm, looped around Augie's mane coat, prevented anyone from stepping too close and jostling the carefully coiffed hair. By contrast, Aunt Peg was letting Coral play at the end of her leash. The rambunctious puppy briefly dropped her head to sniff at something enticing in the grass before bounding back up like a gazelle. Her pomponed tail, held high in the air, wagged back and forth with delight. I watched the boisterous display with surprise. Aunt Peg was a formidable competitor, and this carefree behavior, on the way to the show ring no less, was very unlike her. "I guess you really are here for the experience," I said.
"Every puppy should have a good time at her first dog show," Aunt Peg replied. "Besides, it's not as if she has any real hair to muss."
Augie's regal topknot towered nearly a foot in the air. Coral's resembled a wispy black bottle brush. The fringe on her ears barely reached the end of her leathers. In her puppy trim, with a blanket of shaped hair covering her entire body, Coral was more cute than imposing. Compared to the other standard bitches, Coral would look like a baby, which was exactly what she was. Aunt Peg reached over and poked Davy in the shoulder.
"There's a major today in dogs. I expect you to look sharp. Augie should be very competitive in this company."
Davy nodded, but didn't reply. He already knew what was on the line, and unfortunately, pressure from Aunt Peg was nothing new. In order to attain its championship, a dog needed to earn 15 points in same-sex competition. The judging began with the classes for unfinished dogs. As she had yet to turn a year old, Coral was entered in the puppy bitch class. Augie, a mature dog ready to take on the toughest class competitors, was in open dogs. When the class judging had been completed, each individual class winner returned to the ring to vie for the titles of winner's dog and winner's bitch. Those two were the only entrants to receive points. The number of points awarded ranged from 1 to 5 and was determined by the amount of competition beaten. Two majors, awards of 3 or more points, were required to complete a dog's championship. Major wins were highly sought after and always difficult to attain. Augie had previously accumulated 11 points toward his championship, including 1 major. Coral, about to make her show ring debut, obviously had yet to earn even 1. The area near the in gate of the standard poodle ring was already crowded with handlers and dogs. Inside the ring, the judge was quickly working his way through a small entry of Lauchen. Aunt Peg stopped to talk to someone she knew. Davy paused at the fringes of the activity, eager to keep Augie out of the fray. While Sam remained with him and kept a firm grip on Kev's hand, I slithered between people and poodles and made my way to the steward's table to pick up our numbered armbands. As I waited my turn, Terry appeared beside me, intent on the same mission. In Standard Poodles, he and Crawford had a class dog, a class bitch, and a champion specials dog who would be competing for best of variety. Terry sidled closer and said out of the side of his mouth,
"How is Augie's bite?"
"Fine," I whispered back.
"He's not missing any teeth?"
"No, why?"
"Mr. Logan is a real stickler for correct dentition."
Some breed standards disqualify dogs for an incorrect bite or missing teeth. The poodle standard wasn't one of them. But even so, every judge carried his own preferences and idiosyncrasies into the ring with him.
"You can't blame him," Terry said.
That piqued my interest. I turned and stared until he continued.
"Mr. Logan once stuck his hand into a Doberman's mouth and cut his finger on the dog's braces. He had to get stitches."
I reared back in surprise. Missing teeth are a minor infraction compared to braces. Artificial enhancements were strictly forbidden. "You're making that up," I accused.
"No, really."
Terry was all innocence, like butter wouldn't melt in his mouth. That was the problem with Terry's gossip. I never knew how much to believe.
"Ask Peg, she'll tell you."
Aunt Peg was all the way on the other side of the ring, as Terry knew perfectly well. I grabbed our numbers from the steward and went back to join my family.
"Mr. Logan hasn't even started judging standards yet, and already you look outraged,"
Sam said mildly.
"What is Terry up to now?"
"Apparently, an exhibitor once took a dog into Mr. Logan's ring that was wearing braces on its teeth."
"Oh, yeah."
Sam didn't even blink.
"That's old news."
Even after all the years I'd been involved, when it came to showing dogs, I still sometimes felt like the new kid. Why did everybody always know this stuff but me? "The judge had to get stitches," I said. Sam still wasn't impressed.
"I wouldn't worry about that. I'm sure the cut is healed by now."
"Mom, puppy dogs are in the ring," Davy said urgently. "I need my number." "Oh, right. Time to get back to business." Davy held out his arm. I ran two rubber bands up the sleeve of his jacket, then slid the cardboard square securely underneath. Inside the ring, Mr. Logan was taking his last look at four standard puppies before pinning the class. Aunt Peg came around from the other side of the ring to watch the remainder of the dog judging with us. I handed over her armband, and she slipped it on.
"Crawford should win that class handily," she remarked. "That's a nice puppy he has. He'll give Augie a run for his money in winners."
"Augie has to get out of the open class first," I reminded her. Aunt Peg waved a hand as if that was a given. I wished I had even half her confidence. As usual, however, it turned out that Aunt Peg was right. Crawford's white puppy topped his class easily, and after a prolonged battle, Davy and Augie prevailed over three other dogs in open. Davy accepted his blue ribbon with a grateful smile. Then he hurried Augie back into position as Crawford brought his puppy back into the ring so the two could be judged against each other for winner's dog. Mr. Logan made it look like a close decision, and it probably was. He left Augie at the head of the line until the very last moment. Then, as the two dogs circled the ring one final time, the judge looked back and pointed to Crawford's puppy for the win. My heart sank like a stone. Sam was watching beside me. I felt his shoulders slump. The fact that Davy had been so close to nabbing Augie's elusive second major made us both feel even worse.
"Did Davy win?"
Kevin asked. He had yet to master the intricacies of the judging system. "No," I said glumly. "Not this time." Looking resigned, Davy moved Augie back into line. The dog who'd placed second earlier to Crawford's puppy returned to the ring to be judged for reserve winners. This time, the decision took only a few seconds. Mr. Logan quickly motioned Augie over to the marker and handed Davy the purple and white striped ribbon. Davy exited the ring with a frown on his face. He wasn't upset, just disappointed. We all were.
I really wanted to win that one, he said dejectedly.
I know you did, sweetie. I looped my arms around his shoulders and pulled him close for a hug. Davy usually objects to PDAs from his parents. This time, he didn't even murmur a protest.
But you'll have another chance next week. Augie looks great, and he was really showing well for you.
That puppy of Crawford's is a star in the making, Sam added. It was just bad luck that you and Augie ran into him today. I'm pretty sure the wind finished him, so at least you won't have to worry about him in the future.
That's pathetic, Davy muttered. That dog finished as a puppy, and I've been showing Augie forever.
Pathetic, is it? Aunt Peg inquired.
The judge was still busy marking his book, so the puppy bitches had yet to be called to the ring.
I thought you wanted to show Augie yourself.
I do, Davy protested, but Aunt Peg wasn't finished.
If all that mattered was getting the job done, we could have put that dog with a professional handler and have him finished in no time. Would you prefer that?
No, of course not.
That's what I thought, Aunt Peg sniffed. Now give your nice poodle a pat and let me go take my turn.
Mr. Logan had returned to the center of his ring. The steward called out the numbers of the two standard poodle puppy bitches. Aunt Peg went sweeping past us with Coral bouncing at her side. The fact that Aunt Peg won her small class didn't come as a surprise. Coral might have been immature and inexperienced, but she was still a very pretty poodle. But what happened after that was totally unexpected. The bred by exhibitor class had only a single entry, but there were five nice bitches in open. A lovely brown poodle with a professional handler prevailed, and I assumed she would go on to take the points. That decision looked like an easy one to me, but apparently not to Mr. Logan. He motioned Coral forward to the head of the line and turned the contest into a duel between the puppy and the open bitch. Judging by the expression on Aunt Peg's face, she hadn't anticipated this turn of events either. Aunt Peg is a competitor to the core, however. I could see the exact moment she put aside the notion of Coral using the dog show for experience and got to work beating that other bitch. All at once, she began presenting Coral to the judge as if she was offering the rarest of diamonds for his perusal. The best handlers are skilled at showcasing a dog's good points and drawing the judge's eye away from its faults. Coral was a bit small. Her tail set could have been higher, and she was somewhat lacking in underjaw. However, those flaws were more than offset by her lovely face and expression, her well-angulated shoulder, and her solid top line. When the puppy settled down and moved right, she appeared to float over the ground. And suddenly, Aunt Peg was doing everything she could to make sure Coral was settled and showing effectively. Mr. Logan waffled and wavered for what seemed like an inordinate amount of time. Usually when that happened, it meant a judge didn't particularly like either offering. But Mr. Logan had two nice bitches in front of him. He also had two poodles who couldn't have been more different in age and condition. Under those circumstances, most judges would opt to reward the mature entry. So what was this judge spending so much time thinking about?
Aunt Peg's going to win, Kevin said.
Sam had picked him up so he could see the ring better.
I think you're right. I sounded shocked. I was shocked.
And I wasn't the only one. When the judge pointed to Coral for winner's bitch, Davy released his breath on a long exhale.
How did Aunt Peg do that? He asked.
Sam shrugged, looking equally bemused.
Magic?
When it came to Aunt Peg's powers, anything was possible. After that, the best of variety judging proceeded in a more conventional manner. Crawford's handsome special was awarded BOV over two other champions. His white puppy, now being handled by Terry, was best of winners. Coral, the only bitch in the ring, was awarded best of opposite sex. With an auspicious debut like that, I assumed Aunt Peg would remain at ringside to have Coral's picture taken with the judge. But when the rest of the family went trooping back to the handler's tent, Aunt Peg and Coral fell in behind us. I started to ask her about a win photo, then saw the expression on her face and thought better of the idea. Aunt Peg appeared to be seriously disgruntled by the outcome. Crawford and Terry had stayed to have their winners' pictures taken, but Birdie was standing in her setup when we returned. There was a Sheltie on one of her grooming tables and a smooth collie on another, but Birdie was taking a break to consult her program and drink a soda. Her gaze slid over us, one by one.
"I'm guessing it wasn't your best day," she said.
"Augie was reserve," Davy told her. He put the poodle back on the tabletop. Augie would now need to have his tight top knot taken down and the hairspray brushed from his coat.
"But Coral won."
"Congratulations," Birdie cried. Then she looked at Aunt Peg, who was glumly slipping Coral into a crate. The puppy didn't have enough hair to even need brushing out.
"Wait, that's good news, isn't it?"
"You would think," I said. "If Augie had won, we'd all be dancing in the aisles." Well, maybe not Davy, who rolled his eyes at that. But hey, he's 13, so that's par for the course. The rest of us would have been doing a serious jitterbug. Birdie watched as Aunt Peg silently pulled the two ribbons out of her pocket and tossed them into her tack box.
"Coral was best opposite, too? That's terrific. Did you get a picture?"
"No,"
Aunt Peg frowned.
"Why not?"
Instead of replying, Aunt Peg turned to Sam.
"Suppose you were judging bitches today. Who would you have put up?"
Sam answered without hesitation.
"The brown bitch. She deserved the win."
"Yes, she did,"
Aunt Peg agreed.
"Coral never should have beaten her."
"So what?" I said. "We've all had days when we should have won but didn't. It's nice to have things go the other way for a change."
"It's not nice,"
Aunt Peg grumbled.
"Walter Logan should have known better. He should have judged better. That result never should have happened."
"So why did it?" I asked.
"I have no idea. I suppose I'll have to ask him next time I see him."
Birdie snorted under her breath. We all looked her way.
"What?"
asked Aunt Peg.
"You're kidding, right? Your puppy won the points on a day when she shouldn't have, and you honestly don't know why?"
"Certainly not,"
Aunt Peg said sharply.
"Please enlighten me."
Sam cleared his throat. Suddenly, I realized he also knew what Birdie was thinking.
"As Melanie said, we've all been beaten when we shouldn't have been. Sometimes because a judge plays politics and puts up a professional over an owner-handler."
"I certainly don't see how that applies."
Aunt Peg looked nonplussed.
"I'm an owner-handler."
"Oh, please," said Birdie. "If you're a normal owner-handler, I'm Winnie the Pooh."
Aunt Peg's eyes narrowed. She was not amused.
"Are you saying that my win was due to politics?"
"Think about it," I said. "You're a judge yourself, and you obviously know Walter Logan."
"I know everybody in the dog world,"
Aunt Peg sputtered. "Precisely my point," I affirmed.
"And don't forget about the intimidation factor,"
Birdie added.
"What intimidation factor?"
asked Aunt Peg. Davy laughed out loud. After a few seconds, the rest of us, except for Aunt Peg, followed.
"But it shouldn't matter who is showing the dog."
Aunt Peg's tone bordered on outrage.
"They're supposed to be judging the other end of the lead."
"That's how it works in your ring," Sam replied mildly. "But not everywhere."
"But..."
Aunt Peg was sputtering again.
That's not fair.
Maybe you should hire a professional handler for Coral, Aunt Peg, Davy said innocently.
Okay, that was fresh, but it was also pretty funny.
Sam spun away to hide a grin. Bertie abruptly got busy digging in her tack box. I swallowed a laugh and bent down under the grooming table to see how Kevin was doing.
Aunt Peg drew herself up to her full height. She glared around at us as if we'd suddenly morphed into a bunch of backstabbing traitors.
You people are all annoying me, she announced. I'm going to go pick up my new leash. Hopefully, by the time I return, you will have realized the error of your ways.
Fat chance of that, Davy muttered under his breath.
Thankfully, I appeared to be the only one who heard him.
Aunt Peg hadn't even been gone 5 minutes when my cell phone rang. I showed the name on the screen to Sam and Bertie and said,
Do you think she wants to apologize?
I should have known better.
Aunt Peg was already talking before I even got the phone to my ear.
Melanie, run quickly to the ambulance at the end of the field. It's needed right away at Jasmine's booth.
Is somebody hurt? All at once I felt guilty. It's not you, is it?
I'm fine, Aunt Peg snapped. More or less, anyway. But Jasmine Crane isn't. She appears to be dead.
Chapter 3.
No, I said. That can't be right.
What can't? Asked Sam.
He came and took the phone out of my hand. He listened for a few seconds and then said,
We'll be right there.
Bertie beckoned me into her setup, away from the boys.
What's the matter?
You know Jasmine, the art lady who makes the custom leashes? I whispered. Bertie nodded. Aunt Peg says she's dead.
Bertie's face paled. How? When?
I don't know. That's all she told me.
I was still having trouble absorbing the news myself. I turned back to Davy and raised my voice to normal volume. Sam and I are going to go see about something with Aunt Peg. You're in charge of Kevin.
But
the magnitude of my glare stopped that protest in its tracks.
Okay, Davy said grudgingly.
Not perfect, but I'd take it.
I currently had bigger problems to worry about than a mouthy teenager.
Sam headed for the ambulance and the EMTs. I went straight to Jasmine Crane's booth. It was on the edge of the park, located near the end of a long line of concessions. Most of them appeared to be doing a brisk business. With the sun shining and the first hint of spring in the air, it was a beautiful day for a dog show. Scores of spectators were wandering around the area, checking out the wares. Even as I hurried closer, nothing looked amiss. I knew Aunt Peg almost never got things wrong, but I was desperately hoping she'd been mistaken. On one side of Jasmine's booth, another vendor was selling dog-related books. On the other, a pet supply company had set out pallets of kibble and stacks of brightly colored foam-padded beds. Intent on reaching Aunt Peg, I barely spared either business a glance. As I approached from the front, Jasmine's booth looked much the same as it always had. Like the other concessions, it was covered by a tent. But while the others were open on the sides for easy access, Jasmine's booth was partially enclosed by the portable walls on which she showcased her paintings. A table at the front of the enclosure displayed samples of her collars and leashes, notable for their exotic materials and intricate beading. On a normal day, Jasmine would have been standing out in front of her booth, talking to browsers and inviting them to step inside for a closer look. Though I didn't know her personally, our paths had crossed on numerous occasions. The dog show circuit was like a giant traveling circus. The locations changed from week to week, but the same participants showed up repeatedly. After a while, almost everyone started to look familiar. Now I pictured a woman in her 40s, with dark, curly hair and striking green eyes. Jasmine's clothing style was bohemian chic. She favored peasant tops and colorful tiered skirts, often accented with oversized jewelry. I assumed that her free spirit flower child look was probably part preference and part performance, meant to enhance her image as an artiste. The front section of Jasmine's booth was empty. I strode past the table and dodged around a tall freestanding partition that served as an interior display. Now I could see the rear portion of the enclosed stand. With the sun shining behind her, Aunt Peg was outlined in a narrow doorway. The opening led to the area behind the booths where the vendors parked their trucks and stored their extra stock. Aunt Peg spun around as I approached.
Finally, did you bring help?
Sam went to get the EMTs. He and the ambulance should be here soon. I skidded to a stop beside her and tried to peer through the doorway. Aunt Peg yanked me back.
Don't look. Trust me, you'd rather not see that.
What happened? Are you sure Jasmine is dead? Did she have a heart attack? I know CPR, maybe we can help.
We can't.
Aunt Peg's forceful reply left no room for argument.
Jasmine is beyond our help, or anyone's for that matter. I've called 911. The police are on their way.
I fell back in shock. Suddenly, I was quite sure that Aunt Peg was right. I didn't want to see what lay on the other side of the doorway. The police? I blew out a breath. Immediately, I felt as though I needed more air. But why?
Jasmine was strangled, and it looks like one of her own leashes was used to do the job.
Not yours, I hope. The words just popped out. Then I wanted to kick myself.
No, Aunt Peg said dryly. Though I suspect my hopes of securing that particular item will go unfulfilled.
She stopped and shook her head.
What a shame.
Hopefully she was talking about Jasmine's death, and not her missing custom order. We couldn't see the rest of the showground from where we were, but Aunt Peg and I both heard the sound of running feet. Sam must have arrived with the medics. I stepped around the partition and went out to the front of the booth. The ambulance was now parked at the end of the vendor's row. Sam and two EMTs were covering the last bit of distance on foot. I waved them over to the right place, then moved aside to let them pass. Sam stopped when he saw me. The medics kept going and ducked inside the booth. I figured Aunt Peg could tell them what they needed to know. Sam looked at me inquiringly. Slowly, I shook my head. It wasn't an accident. Jasmine was strangled. Aunt Peg has called the police.
How awful.
Sam briefly closed his eyes as he processed the news.
And even worse for Peg to have been the one who found her.
Aunt Peg's voice reached us from the back of the booth.
Young man, the police are on their way. I think you'd better wait until they arrive before touching anything.
If she received a reply, it wasn't audible. A moment later, Aunt Peg came around the partition and walked outside to join us.
Well, I tried, but those two were determined to go about their business, even if it meant contaminating a crime scene. If I'm so intimidating, how come I couldn't intimidate them?
You can't blame them for wanting to do their job, Sam said. And I'm glad they're here to take charge. Now that Jasmine's death has been reported, I think we should leave the authorities to deal with it. Good idea, I replied. Knowing what lay on the other side of those walls, I had no desire to linger. Sam and I started to walk away. Aunt Peg didn't move. Instead, she positioned herself in the entrance to Jasmine's booth, crossed her arms over her chest, and stood like a sentinel poised to deny access to interlopers. Sam paused.
Peg, are you coming?
No, I'll wait here until the police arrive. I imagine they'll want to talk to me.
Knowing Aunt Peg, she'd probably have questions for them, too. Back at the grooming tent, Davy had finished taking Augie's hair down and was giving the standard poodle a drink. Bertie must have been up at the rings, but in the setup on our other side, there was a rare lull in the activity. Crawford was leaning against a stack of crates, looking at something on his phone. Terry was sitting in the grass, playing with Kevin. Terry saw Sam and me and shot to his feet.
"Something's happened," he said.
"So help me, there was more?" "What now?" I asked.
"I have no idea, but you two look awful. What's wrong?"
Sam gave his head a slight shake to silence us. Then he turned to Davy.
"Hey, sport, why don't you take your brother over to the rings and watch the Dalmatian judging? You know how Kev loves dogs with spots."
Davy wasn't dumb. He knew something was up.
"You guys are going to talk about something you don't want me to hear."
Before I could reply, Terry chimed in.
"Yes, we are."
His voice dropped to a confidential tone.
"But don't worry, I'll tell you all about it later."
I waited until Davy had taken his brother's hand and the two of them had departed before saying, "You will not."
"Of course I won't," Terry agreed. "But it got them moving, didn't it?"
"You lied to my children."
"It's good for them. They should know better than to trust strangers." "You're not a stranger," Sam pointed out. "Oh, for Pete's sake."
Crawford looked up from his phone.
"If I promise to yell at him later, will you quit bickering and tell us what's the matter?"
"Jasmine Crane is dead," I said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.